हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम बैक टू नोटवर्दी ईएनटी। विल बी डिस्कसिंग अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक टुडे व्हिच हैज कम टू द फोर इन दिस कोविड पैंडेमिक एंड दैट इज म्यूकोरमाइकोसिस इन कोविड। सो व्हाट इज दिस म्यूकोरमाइकोसिस? इट इज अ रेयर फंगल इन्फेक्शन व्हिच इज कॉज्ड बाय द मेंबर्स ऑफ क्लास जाइगोमाइसिटीज ऑफ द ऑर्डर म्यूकोरेल्स। And genera in this order which leads to this infection are rhizopus and mucor mainly, but can also be caused by absidia and rarely by succinia and cunningamella. Now this fungus is ubiquitous in the environment, that is, it is already present in the environment and it may also be present in our nasal mucosa already, but it affects only the immunocompromised individuals. Immunocompromised, for example, a patient who has received steroids having COVID-19, that is a patient with COVID-19 who is on steroids. What happens is in COVID-19, the body's immune system, it goes into overdrive, and to prevent this overdrive, we have to give anti-inflammatory drugs such as steroids. And these are very important to prevent the complications in COVID. But however, giving these steroids, it decreases the immunity and raises the blood sugar levels. And as a result of this decreased immunity, a lot of opportunistic infections can occur. And mucormycosis is one such opportunistic infection. Why is this important? Because it has a very high morbidity and a mortality ranging up to around 50%. Now, COVID-associated mucormycosis can be classified depending on the clinical presentation, and the most common being rhino-orbito-cerebral mucormycosis. That is the mucormycosis occurring in the nasal cavity, which may spread to the orbit and the brain. It is most common in people with uncontrolled diabetes and post-kidney transplant patients. So we'll be mainly discussing this type of mucormycosis. The other types are pulmonary mucormycosis, GI mucormycosis, disseminated mucormycosis, and primary cutaneous mucormycosis. But we'll be restricting our discussion to rhino-orbito-cerebral mucormycosis. So what are the risk factors? It can be a case of concurrently or recently treated severe COVID-19. So a patient with COVID-19 can develop this concurrently. That means that at the time of having COVID-19 also and after just recovering from COVID-19 within 6 to 8 weeks. And in case of uncontrolled diabetes mellitus or with the use of immunosuppressive drugs such as steroids, tocilizumab or some other immunomodulators. The patients with prolonged neutropenia are also at a risk to develop this disease. Similarly, post-transplant or malignancy patient. The malignancy can be a solid or hematopoietic malignancy. Patients with prolonged ICU stays and prolonged hospitalization and prolonged ventilators are also predisposed, and if the patient has received voriconazole therapy, this is given in patients with aspergillosis, but it predisposes to mucormycosis, and deferoxamine therapy or other iron loading therapies. If the patient is having high free serum iron in the body, it predisposes to mucor because mucor feeds on the iron. Now, how can this rhino-orbital cerebral mucormycosis present? That is the clinical presentation. So, it usually starts in the nose and the patient may complain of nasal blockade or congestion. The patient can have discharge from the nasal cavity and this discharge can be blackish, blood-stained or purulent. The patient can have facial pain, numbness or swelling, which is usually unilateral. There may be crusting or blackish discoloration in the nasal cavity, and blackish discoloration कैन बी देयर ओवर द नेजल ब्रिज, ओवर द पैलेट और अराउंड द आईज। ऑर्बिटल सिम्टम्स आर यूजली देयर मे बी प्रोप्टोसिस, कीमोसिस, ऑफ्थैल्मोप्लीजिया, सडन लॉस ऑफ विजन और ब्लर्ड विजन ऑल्सो। द पेशेंट कैन हैव पेन इन द टीथ और लूजनिंग ऑफ टीथ। द पेशेंट मे हैव फीवर, हेडेक, चेस्ट पेन, प्लूरल इफ्यूजन और देर मे बी वर्सनिंग ऑफ रेस्पिरेटरी सिम्टम्स। इफ द डिजीज स्प्रेड्स टू द ब्रेन, द पेशेंट मे हैव ऑल्टर्ड मेंटल स्टेटस और देर मे बी रैपिड डिटीरियोरेशन ऑफ जनरल कंडीशन ऑल्सो। सो एज यू कैन सी इन दिस पिक्चर देर इज ब्लैकनिंग ऑफ द स्किन अराउंड द आईज। दिस इज कैरेक्टरिस्टिक ऑफ म्यूकोरमाइकोसिस। सिमिलरली यू कैन सी देर इज अ blackening of the palatal area. Now, how do we diagnose this disease? Firstly, the lab parameters, we do the routine blood test, that is the complete blood count, ESR, blood sugar, both the fasting and postprandial, HbA1c, liver function test, kidney function test, along with electrolytes and viral markers. Important tests are an early diagnostic nasal endoscopy. In the diagnostic nasal endoscopy, there may be crusting in the nasal cavity, there may be debris, discolored mucosa which may be black or pale, and the part, diseased part may have decreased bleeding and insensate mucosa. As you can see in this endoscopic picture, there is discoloration of this turbinate, and with due course of time this will turn completely black like this. Now, why there is blackish discoloration? Because this fungus, this is angioinvasive. So, it invades the vessels and causes ischemia of the involved area. And with due course of time, the area becomes necrosed. Then, imaging is very important in mucormycosis. So, we can go ahead with a contrast enhanced CT scan of nose and PNS or a contrast enhanced MRI of nose and PNS. Now, if given a choice, ideally one should like to have both the investigations, but if we have to choose one, then a contrast enhanced MRI gives more information than the CT scan. Now, in the CT scan, as we know, it gives an excellent bony detail. So if there is erosion or thinning of the bones, we get to detect in the CT scan. But the MRI, it gives excellent soft tissue details. So we get to know whether there is involvement of the optic nerve, cavernous sinus, or there is intracranial involvement, or if the disease has progressed to the pterygopalatine fossa or the infratemporal fossa. Now, as you can see in this CT scan, on the left, in the left maxillary sinus, there is haziness, and this haziness has spread to the inferomedial part of the orbit also. And similarly, in the axial scan, you can see there is some haziness in the orbit near the orbital apex area. Now, coming to this MRI, this is a contrast enhanced MRI coronal section, and as you can see, the turbinates on the left side are not taking up the contrast, and this is known as a black turbinate sign. This happens because this area has become necrosed and this devitalized tissue does not take up contrast. So getting this information is very important, because if we are planning for surgery, that is debridement, we have to debride all the necrosed area. So with the contrast enhanced MRI, we can understand what area has already become necrosed and what area is still vital. So this information is very helpful when we are planning for surgery. Similarly, a coronal section and contrast enhanced MRI, you can see the disease is in the left maxillary sinus in the nasal cavity, and it has also spread to the orbit, and similarly to the, and also it has spread to the opposite side also. So orbital involvement can be seen in this picture. Now coming to this picture of, if you see closely, this is the right cavernous sinus and this is the left cavernous sinus, and this being the carotids. Now you can see that the left cavernous sinus is not taking up the contrast. That means it has become devitalized and already involved by the disease. Now coming to the microscopy, we can do with potassium hydroxide staining, and it can also be stained with periodic acid shift. This mucor is non-septate or posiseptate and has ribbon-like broad hyphae with vessel occlusion. Now important thing about this direct microscopy is when we send the swabs, it has to be sent in normal saline. Similarly, fungal culture is also sent in normal saline. These are cultured in routine media at 30 and 37 degrees Celsius with the typical finding of cotton white or grayish black colonies. And histopathology is done to differentiate it from other molds, and we have to look for angioinvasion in the histopathology. Coming to the treatment requires a multidisciplinary team as the disease encompasses a lot of specialties. So a lot of different specialties have to come together for the appropriate management. So the general guidelines are that we have to control the diabetes and diabetic ketoacidosis. We have to reduce the steroids if the patient is still taking steroids with the aim to discontinue quickly. We have to discontinue the immunomodulating drugs, and as of now there is no role of antifungal prophylaxis, and we have to give appropriate medical and surgical management. Now medical management is very very important, and amphotericin B is the drug of choice. However, we can also use posaconazole or isavuconazole. This amphotericin B, it comes in four forms. That is the amphotericin B deoxycholate, that is the conventional amphotericin B, then the amphotericin B lipid complex, amphotericin B liposomal, and amphotericin B colloidal dispersion. So there is not much of difference in the efficacy, but we prefer the liposomal amphotericin B as it has the least side effect profile. Coming to the dosage, if you are using liposomal amphotericin B, the dose is around 5 mg per kg per day. However, if there is intracranial involvement, then the dose is doubled to around 10 mg per kg per day. And in case of conventional amphotericin B, the dose is 1 to 1.5 milligram per kg per day. Coming to the administration of amphotericin B, this is very important and every resident should know about the administration. So we'll be discussing the administration of liposomal amphotericin B mainly. So one vial is of 50 milligram and we have to reconstitute it with 12 ml of sterile water. So we have to use sterile water and not normal saline. So the solution comes to around 4 mg per ml after reconstitution. So we have to shake this solution vigorously and make a translucent solution. Now this amphotericin B, it comes as a yellowish powder. So after reconstitution, we have to make this a yellowish translucent solution. Now we have to give the test dose before the therapeutic dose. So what we do is we take 1 ml of this solution and infuse it with 100 ml of D5 over 20 to 30 minutes. And over this time, we have to look for any fever or adverse reactions if they are occurring. So in case there are no adverse reactions, we give the therapeutic dose. But before giving therapeutic dose, we have to prehydrate the patient. So prehydration is done with 500 ml of normal saline over 30 minutes. It can also be given with 1 ampule of KCl to prevent the renal toxicity and hypokalemia. This renal toxicity and hypokalemia are the main adverse effects of amphotericin B. Then after prehydration, we give the therapeutic dose. So appropriate dose of the drug is diluted with D5 so that the solution becomes around 0.5 to 2 mg per ml, and this solution is given over 2 to 3 hours and the bottle is covered in a black sheet as it crystallizes in light. So we have to prevent the light, and we have to post hydrate the patient similarly with 500 ml of normal saline over 30 minutes. So just a quick revision. One vial is 50 milligrams. We have to reconstitute it with 12 ml of sterile water. And 1 ml of this is transfused with 100 ml of D5 over 20 to 30 minutes as the test dose. Then prehydrate the patient with 500 ml NS. Then the therapeutic dose of the drug is given. Just to give you an idea, what does this appropriate dosage and diluting with D5 means? For example, let us take that the patient is 50 kilograms and taking 5 mg per kg as the dose, the patient requires 250 milligrams. So this 250 milligrams require 5 vials as 1 vial is 50 milligrams. And after reconstitution, if we dilute it with 250 ml of D5, so 250 mg is diluted in 250 ml. So this becomes around 1 mg per ml. So we have to dilute in the region of 0.5 to 2 mg per ml. And then we post hydrate with 500 ml of NS over 30 minutes. And important to measure the kidney function test along with serum electrolytes every 24 to 48 hours. Now, how long do we have to give this amphotericin B? For at least 2 to 6 weeks. For a minimum of 2 weeks up to 6 weeks depending on the clinical resolution and radiological stabilization. So when we find that the disease has stabilized, and we can then shift to the step down therapy with oral posaconazole, and this is continued till complete clinical and radiological resolution. So this posaconazole is a broad spectrum antifungal which is available in both oral and injectable forms. So in the oral form, we give it as 300 milligrams BD on the first day and then 300 milligrams OD subsequently, and it is given along with food to enhance the absorption. Similarly, isavuconazole is also available in both oral and injectable forms, and the loading dose is 200 milligrams 3 times a day for 2 days followed by 200 milligrams once daily, and to increase the absorption it is taken with a high fat diet. Coming to the surgical management, the surgical debridement is to be done at the earliest to remove all the dead and necrotic tissue from inside the nasal cavity. Important to note that this can be staged. It does not need to be a single stage surgery, but we should try to remove as much as possible in the first setting itself. And it can be done endoscopically and with the open approach also. In case the skin is involved, obviously we have to take the open approach. Now when we are debriding endoscopically, Denker's approach is the preferred approach. Why it is so? Because it helps in routine surveillance during follow-up. During follow-up, we have to routinely do an endoscopy to detect if there is any recurrence of the disease. So it helps in surveillance during follow-up. Now, in case there is significant orbital involvement or involvement of the orbital apex, it may require orbital excentration also. So, important that the patient has to be treated properly. All the necrosed part has to be removed. The life takes precedence over sight in this case. This completes the topic of mucormycosis in COVID. So please leave your feedback or any recommendation in the comments below. If you like what I am doing, then please support me by liking the video and subscribing to my channel. Thank you.